Hips, like all joints, deteriorate for a number of reasons. Essentially, that process means that the cartilage wears down to where bone is exposed on bone. And it can happen with wear and tear arthritis, which we term osteoarthritis, inflammatory diseases such as lupus, psoriatic arthritis, or rheumatoid arthritis, or it can happen after accidents, which we term post-traumatic arthritis.
Well, early on, we always treat them with non-operative measures first, so what people refer to as conservative measures, and that consists of the non-operative things, so use of anti-inflammatory medication, maybe use of glucosamine and chondroitin sulfate, those kind of things that you can buy over the counter, activity modification, and then trying to get to and maintain the proper body weight. Sometimes that's an issue for some patients, so we'll counsel them on weight reduction. But those are the main things that people can do initially to try to prolong the life of their native joint until they get to the point where they just can't stand it anymore. And then we start talking about the surgical remedy.
Hip replacement becomes a viable option for a patient when their pain and activities are modified greatly. When patients require pain pills and walking aids during the day, when it affects their sleep at night, when they can't participate in the activities that they like, and that correlates with their examination and significant x-ray changes, then they may be a candidate to have a hip replacement procedure. When we operate on an anterior type approach, there are several things different than the traditional approach. The patients aren't turned onto the side, but rather they're supine or flat. Anesthesiologists tend to prefer this approach.
Now we can come in from the front, not take down any bone, not take down any muscles or tendon attachments, and basically go into the joint, replace the joint, and then just close the capsule and the fascia and then the skin without having to reattach any muscles and tendons. So it makes a huge difference in terms of the patient's discomfort postoperatively and how fast they progress.
We also use a special table that allows us not only to place the components very precisely, but it also allows for x-ray guidance so that we can see what's happening inside the bone. This allows us to balance the leg and make it match the opposite side, both for length as well as offset. This keeps even tension on the muscles, and along with not transecting the muscles is one of the reasons for a more rapid recovery on the part of the patient. Hip replacement surgery has been a viable option in this country since 1969, and so there's a vast amount of experience and there are many, many approaches. We feel that the anterior approach differs from the other approaches in that it doesn't transect muscle or tendon and allows for a much easier recovery for the patient.
The advantages of the patient, I think, are twofold. First is just the fact that it is an easier procedure to recover from, so less immediate pain after surgery and a much faster recovery from the surgery. The second way that it's advantageous to the patient is that we can do a better job putting it in that way, in that with the use of the intraoperative imaging, we can do a better job of positioning the prosthesis in the appropriate place and do a better job of replicating their offset and their length. So the issue of limb length inequality after hip replacement really goes away with this technique, in that it allows us to make sure before we ever leave the operating room that we have the offset and the length correct. And I think that's a huge advantage for the patient as well.
For more information about this physician or to schedule an appointment, please call our referral line or visit notbiggerjustbetterhealth.com.